Over the last half decade, few people have made a bigger impact in the world of basketball than Natisha Hiedeman. She's here to talk all about her career, her move to Minnesota, her coaching, so much more. Lockdown Women's Basketball starts now.
Ogumba Wale for the win.
You are Locked On Women's Basketball, your daily podcast on women's basketball.
Well, hi, everyone, and happy Thursday. I am host Howard Megdal, welcoming you to Locked On Women's Basketball. I want to thank you for making us your first listen every day. You guys keep showing up for us, over 180,000 of you listening in February alone, the way we show up for you 6 days a week. And of course, it's not just me. It is the entire incredible team over at The Next. At thenexthoops.com, we have over 100 reported pieces every single month on women's basketball. Right now, as we speak, we have people fanned out all over the country at ACC conference tournament, at Pac-12 conference tournament, Big 12 coming up very soon, and of course, at the Big 10 conference tournament. Really fascinated to see what happens out there. Natisha Hiedeman's out there too, because you would say, all right, it would be enough to be an elite playmaking guard in the WNBA, or it would be enough to be coaching at Penn State and helping the Nittany Lion revival. But Natisha, you do both. And I guess where I want to start is talking about that balance, how you strike that balance, how you find your time, your boundaries, all of that in the midst of doing, you know, effectively two jobs at the same time.
Honestly, I would just say it's a lot of credit to the head coach, Carolyn Keeger. She just allows me to, you know, practice with the girls. And then she also takes time out of her busy schedule to work me out and do individuals with me. So definitely greatly appreciate that. And then, yeah, a lot of the other time is spent coaching the girls and watching a lot of film and a lot of scouts and a lot of video.
I remember the night you were drafted, and as somebody who's covered the Big East, I had a sense of what kind of player you are, what kind of player you were at the time, and you've improved even since. But just to set the stage for people to understand, all right, you have been, over the time in your career, a 39.2% shooter from three-point range. That is, since you entered the league, that is eighth of anyone in the league. This is no shade on people like Kelsey Mitchell or Chelsea Gray or Sabrina Ionescu or Jewel Lloyd. These are all elite shooters. You're ahead of all of them when it comes to making threes. It is not by any means the solo part of your game, but it is a significant part of your game. So to see somebody who comes in with, you know, what the scouts call this carrying tool, to be drafted 18th overall, just take me through the emotions that night, how you felt, especially there's then a trade and you're off to Connecticut to know, gee, I have a lot that I get to prove now.
Yeah. I just remember draft night. I was surrounded by all my family and friends and just people who supported me throughout my career. And I remember my niece at the time had to be like 7, and she had a sign with all the teams. And she wanted me to go to Chicago or Minnesota because those were the two teams that were closest to home, being from Green Bay. So when I got drafted to Minnesota initially, she was just like the happiest kid on earth. And I just remember, like, you know, I'm so excited to be able to play close to home. And then I'm in the middle of an interview. And like during that interview, they're like, all right, scratch that. We got to cut it. You just got traded to Connecticut. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, you know, everything like starts changing. Then I see my niece. My niece is like bawling, sobbing, crying, throwing a temper tantrum at 7. And so now I feel like just being to be able to come back here, it's like a full circle moment for me. And I'm super excited, and I feel like it's definitely going to be a fun and exciting journey.
We on the East Coast had the privilege of having you here for a half a decade. But like you said, these are obviously these Midwest roots that you've got, whether it's your starring in Green Bay growing up, whether it's the fact that you're now not only playing in the Midwest, but also coaching? I mean, Penn State, I guess, is east relative to most of the Big Ten. I mean, I guess that'll be even truer next year when UCLA and USC get there. But does it feel like more at home in the Midwest, just being able to now connect those things, you know, your playing career with your coaching career at this point?
Yeah, this is like Midwest. I've always been a Midwest baby. I just grew up here. I went to school, to college in the Midwest. Like I said, I'm a big family person. So just being able to be back closer to my family. You know, when you're happy off the court, you're playing great on the court. So I feel like this is going to be a really exciting season for me. And I'm looking forward to it. And I've been putting in a lot of work in the offseason. So I'm just excited to get the ball rolling.
You look at that team you played for, like you said, at Marquette. And again, you shot 39.1% from three your senior year of college. This is not a new thing. That team ended up 27-8. You know, a very impressive team on the floor. When you got to the pros, what did you feel like you needed to work on first? And what's been sort of that biggest growth in your game as you see it from then to now?
I think just once I got to the pros, like, you know, you're kind of small, like you're going to be playing a point guard. So just understanding the leadership and everything that comes with being a point guard, a lot of communication and just understanding, you know, putting people in the right position. So I feel like for me, constantly every day, like even now, I'm just trying to understand the game better from a bigger picture, not just, you know, one position or this position or that position, but understanding the whole game. And that's where I think coaching has really helped me too, because it's allowed me to see things from a different perspective. And so I would say just working on that leadership. And then I always just wanted to be a defensive, get better on defense as well. Just being able to ball hawk and, you know, be feisty. Like I said, a little bit undersized. So just being able to do what I can with that.
You talk about understanding it from a different perspective as a coach. Before you even got this gig at Penn State, and listeners, you ought to note, Natisha was on the staff last year, immediately got promoted. So, you know, it's worth pointing out that obviously is something you have taken to and that's been recognized, which is obviously really gratifying for, you know, for us to see from the outside. It has to be for you as well. But was seeing it film, have you always been a film person when it comes to breaking down the game and thinking about it?
I feel like, you know, growing up, like I might have watched a lot of film, watched a lot of games, but I never, you know, broke it down like how I break it down now. Like I'm on sports code now every day, like clipping, circling, drawing lines, arrows, watching other people, doing tapes where, you know, comparisons, similar basketball styles. So I feel like, yes, I've always watched film, but it's a little bit different when I'm breaking it down for myself or for other people. I just see it completely different.
It's an interesting perspective for sure. And again, I want to get even more into your WNBA journey as well, but just from that perspective, as you sort of think through coming into it's a game day. So you're about to play in a Big Ten tournament. Where are your responsibilities when it comes to coaching? Are you breaking down a particular aspect of things? Are you working primarily with guards? Just kind of take us through what your day has been like and what's ahead.
Yeah, so today, I mean, yesterday we had a lot. We watched film with the team. This morning we did like a walkthrough, you know, walking through the opponent's plays, just making sure that we're ready, knowing our schemes, our coverages, everything, going through, you know, just our offense, making sure everything's running smoothly. I don't want to say like I primarily focus on the guards, because I definitely pour a lot of energy and effort and attention into the bigs as well. But I definitely can help the guards a little bit more, just being a guard and always being a guard and playing that position. So I definitely take a lot of pride in the guards and helping them with anything that they need. As far as like on game day coach, you know, I'm warming up with everybody. Definitely bringing a lot of energy. That's what I feel like I do the best, is make sure the girls have energy, make sure, you know, everything is good with them. I think a lot of times, you know, as coaches, you know, we're like focus so much on the game. And I think me personally, I make sure everything else is good in their lives too, so that when they step on the court, they're good to go and they're ready to play and making sure that they're feeling good and confident.
Well, they're lucky to have you. And it's great to see. Hopefully they continue to do what they did in the last time out, 13 threes. So emulating you on the court as well in that 90-34 win over Minnesota. You guys are obviously playing really well. We'll get a little more into that and also just talking about what your journey has been like, because it has been anything but easy. And I think our listeners ought to know about that. So right back in segment two with Natisha Hiedeman. But first, I want to talk to you guys about one of our sponsors today, and that is Nissan. Nissan offers a lot of different options for if you are looking to push things further. We have a lineup of SUVs over at Nissan with the capabilities of taking your adventure to the next level. So there's the 2024 Nissan Rogue, which has so much. It's got the 12.3-inch HD touchscreen infotainment system. It's got Google Maps, Google Assistant. Thank goodness for that. I never know where I'm going without the help of technology. So they have that in place, but it's not the only option. There's the Nissan Pathfinder. Let's say the family is a little bigger. It has room up to 8 cargo capacity and 6,000 pounds of towing in the Nissan Pathfinder. And then the extra large, the 2024 Nissan Armada, 4x4 seating, 8 first class seats. You can tow bigger and even explore further with the Nissan Armada. So take the Road, the Pathfinder, or the Nissan Armada for a test drive, and then go find your next big adventure. How? Shop NissanUSA.com. So back when Natisha Hiedeman, and we talked about an adventure, but it had to be a fraught one. You were drafted, traded, at one point cut, playing for multiple teams over the course of 2019, as you're making your way into the league, what did you tell yourself to be able to keep faith in what you were doing, to be able to establish yourself to the point where you are now an ironwoman playing 40 games, all 40 games, 40 starts last season? What are you telling yourself back then?
It definitely was a journey, but I always just stay positive. I've always had the right people surrounding me and keeping my head on my shoulders. And I just stayed ready all the time. So, yeah, after being cut, just getting the call back, I knew that it was just an opportunity for me, and I was grateful and thankful for it. And I know that I had a good training camp. So the fact that Kurt Miller ended up calling me back was just meant a lot. And I feel like I was able to just – prove to people what I could do, and then I feel like that's what kept me in the league.
You're playing, obviously, in the league, showing what you're able to do with each passing year, getting some additional responsibility. But I remember very well that jump from 21 to 22, where you get to finally be in the starting lineup, where you get the opportunity, you know, and it was bittersweet, obviously, because of the way in which it happened. To be sure, but to get the opportunity to show what you were as a starter, does that stand out in your mind as kind of a turning point in your journey in this league?
It does, but for me, it's never just been like about starting or anything like that. Obviously, when one person goes down, the next person has to step up. And like I said, I've been preparing for whatever happens. So just being able to step in that role, and I feel like I did a good job, and when my number was called up, I was ready. So just to be able to continue that, and then for the team to have faith in me to start next season, I just became more of a leader, and I knew my role on the team and what I needed to do for us to be successful.
Like I said, three-pointers are part of your game and a significant part, but by no means the primary part, I would say, or even certainly not the main one. And I say that by means of there's statistical markers where you're able to see that players are working, right? And one of them was your ability to finish at the rim. And you were at about 50% in 2022 when it came, in 2021 to finish at the rim. That jumped to north of 62% We talked about it at the time, and I don't know if you remember, but I'm looking back at it now. It felt like a moment where we're saying, this is Natisha becoming a more complete player. There's always a story for how it happened. Take me through it. What were you doing? What were you working on? How conscious were you of this as a place where you wanted to get better as a player?
Yeah, I think for me, I just want to continue to grow. I know that, you know, every year it's just been going on an upward path for me, and I want to continue to do that and continue to get better. I don't think that I've reached my full potential yet, so the fact that I don't think I've reached my full potential kind of says a lot, because I know that I have a lot more to give to the game. But it's just been fun and exciting. Just I feel like the confidence that I have going into each year has kind of allowed me to continue to be better. And then, like you said, it kind of goes with the numbers, just better percentages, more confidence. And not only that, but I think that I've had really good people around me, surrounding me, coaches and teammates, which also have, you know, helped build my confidence and made things easier for me. You know, getting a lot of threes wide open, my teammates finding me the ball and stuff like that.
You also have been a consistent performer in the playoffs. You've had the opportunity to play in the playoffs repeatedly. And in fact, I believe every year of your career,
yeah.
Which, you know, if you'll forgive a point of personal privilege for the host, that is not a coincidence that that happened. And so as you started thinking through your future as to where you wanted to be in 24 and beyond, how much was, like you said, being part of a team that has playoff and championship aspirations, part of it? And how much was that central to the way you thought about the way you wanted the next portion of your career to go?
Yeah, I mean, I hope everybody's goal that's in the league is to win a championship. That's for sure mine. Been close a couple of times. So just being able to come play for an organization that, you know, has championships, great coach, great players, being able to play for something, I'm super excited. And like I said, the goal for me is just always been to win a championship, no matter how we got to do it.
So how do you measure that as a free agent, right? We can see it from the outside, but are you taking meetings and listening for what the plan is? Are you looking at, you know, the numbers and seeing how close teams are? Like, how do you evaluate which team is going to give you that best chance? Like you said, you guys were so close on several occasions, that team that's going to give you the opportunity to hoist that trophy. How did you measure it in this process?
I mean, I don't think it's really measurable. I think that, like, one, Minnesota has always just been known for being a great organization. And I think that's first and foremost because how much they pour into the players. And when you have a group behind you that wants you to be successful, it makes it easier. And then you just have to do your job on the court. And Cheryl brought me here for a reason. I know that she believes me, and that's good to have coaches and staff that believe in you. Like I said, it just makes playing easier. So being able to, you know, be somewhere where I wanted, that feels really good. And like I said, I don't think it's really measurable. I think when you gel with your teammates, once you start understanding your teammates, once you start knowing, I think on any given night, anybody could be anybody. So mm-hmm. I think it's how you go into the games, the preparations, everything.
So how did she define this role to you? What is she looking for from you?
I think she just wants me to be me. I think that she wants me to continue to be better. I think she wants me to be a leader, and bring what I brought to a lot of teams, a lot of energy, good vibes, and good just being a good teammate and a good team player.
Well, she doesn't have to wonder if that's going to be, because you've got a track record that says that is exactly what you will be. I'm really interested to see. I want to talk more about the future, all the different ways in which you are not just manifesting yourself upon the basketball scene today, but where it's going to be tomorrow. We'll be right back in segment three. You are all listening to Locked On Women's Basketball. I'm Howard Megdal. Locked On Women's Basketball is brought to you by Game Time. And so, look, a lot of times when I'm going to the game, I am a credentialed reporter. I am there to work. However, during my off time, my younger daughter is a basketball junkie. And so she wants me to take her to ball games too. And when I do, I'm able to use something called game time. Now, why does this matter? I have a very precise younger daughter, and she wants to know not just that we're going to the game. She wants to know where we're sitting. She wants to see the view from where we're sitting. She's got particular players in mind. Natisha, she likes to watch you play. And when she does, she wants to know she's going to be able to get an up close view. And that's why I love the Game Time app, which allows you not just to pick where it is you're sitting, but to see the view from where you're sitting. Last minute seats. Game Day has deals on tickets right up to the start of the event. You can do it by individual seat. You can even do it by zone. So don't take my word for it. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use the code LOCKEDON for $20 off your first purchase. Again, create an account, redeem code LOCKEDON for $20 off. Terms apply. Download Game Time today. Last minute tickets, lowest price guaranteed. Back from Natisha Hiedeman, who I think it's so exciting for me to see your arc, to see the way you're impacting the game as a coach, as a player. I want you to take me through the next 5 years as you continue to grow in this game. Are you looking ultimately, there's championship that's obviously on the list. What else is on the list? Is head coaching on the list? Is, you know, I want to give you your list. What do you have on the agenda?
Yeah, I have like a lot. I have a lot of goals. But one thing that, I mean, I've kind of always stood on was just be where my feet are. Mm-hmm. I'm not looking too far ahead about, like, you know, if I'm going to coach or what the future holds for me. I kind of just leave that to God and go where the water takes me. But I was kind of that way in college too. Like, you know, Coach Keys was, you know, telling me like, hey, like, you know, you have an opportunity to go to the league. I was just chilling, vibing in college, not even thinking about the league. And then, you know, on draft night, that's when I was like, you know, it's reality. So right. For me, just being where my feet are, focusing on the now. But like I said, I do have goals, which I think are important to set. So just like I said, winning a championship is like my main focus right now. And I would say that's like the only future goal that I have. And obviously improving just as a player on the court and then just as a person off the court as well.
You talk about goals and championships. Obviously, this Penn State team, depending on who you ask, is in the tournament, just out of the tournament, right there. To my mind, you have the resume to be in. You play in the Big Ten Conference and you have the record you guys have. That should be enough. Does it feel like there's a certain extra weight to tonight? You talked about being where your feet are. Does beating Wisconsin feel like a game you guys really got to have to make sure you're writing your own ticket?
Yeah, we know it's a must win for us if we want to have any chance of being in the tournament. You know, like, yes, we know we're right on the bubble there, but like I said, we're really focused on one game at a time. So winning this game is our first priority. I feel like the girls are super prepared. Like I said, good vibes, good energy leading up to this game. And I really think they're going to go take care of business and do what they have to do. We definitely write our own fate, so focus on what we can control right now.
And for a tournament, you have a quick turnaround to scout a team a game at a time. You're not even looking at tomorrow, right? You're going to have less than 24 hours to figure it out, right?
Nah, I'm not even looking at tomorrow yet.
What do you do in that scenario, right? It's just you get a good night's sleep and you pick it up in the morning?
Nah, so like after the game – yeah. You know, we win. Mm-hmm. Then we'll on to the next, and then we'll lock in there. Because like you said, it is a short turnaround, so it's just gonna be a lot of mental preparation for the girls, like a lot of film. You know, they're gonna have to stay off their feet and stuff like that. So we're definitely prepared for if we win. But yeah, like I said, focused on the first game first.
And. Definitely focused on that. If you win, the team you're playing is Iowa tomorrow. They've been flying under the radar. No one's really been talking about Iowa or any particular players on Iowa like Caitlin Clark, right? They've been very quiet and I tried. Would there be an extra pleasure in getting another shot at them? I was 111-93. You guys played really well in that game. I know defensively it wasn't what you were looking for, but you were hitting shots. I mean, that was one of the most entertaining games of the season. Would you like another shot, Adam?
Yeah, for sure. They've definitely come with an amazing crowd. So for our girls to be able to play in that atmosphere and just experience that again, I think it would be really good for them. And honestly, I think it would make them compete a little bit harder. So they've been in that atmosphere before. So if it comes again, they'll be ready.
And you'll get to scout your future opponent in real time as you're able to
exactly.
do it. So you can head start on it. Well, Natisha Hiedeman, not surprised, but delighted to see all your success across the basketball spectrum. Always a pleasure to cover you, and I appreciate your time, especially on a game day. To our listeners, thank you for making us your first listen every day. We will be back with you tomorrow. The great Gigi Spear upgrades the host chair, and she'll be joined by Tim Adams talking about the Big East tournament coming up this weekend. So until then, I am Howard Megdal, wishing all of you a wonderful Thursday. Go watch some Big Ten basketball, friends.
Ogumba Wallet for the win.
You are Locked On Women's Basketball, your daily podcast on women's basketball.